Good morning, Wickenburg. Please stand. We have a new song that we did a couple weeks ago. We'd like you to join us. Please stand.
Church, y'all can have a seat. How is everybody? Good. It is good to see you and be in the house. Well, I can't really see you. These lights are crazy this morning. Sound booth, you're doing a great job because you were blinding us terribly. Welcome to church this morning. We're glad you're here. If you don't know me, my name is Tara, and I'm so happy to see your faces today. If you are visiting with us for the first time, make sure you stop at our welcome desk. It's back here in this corner. Let them know it's your first time coming to church, and they'll give you a gift. It's just our way of saying thank you for worshiping with us today. We have a lot of announcements coming up, and there's so many ways to be getting involved. Yesterday, the ladies met. There's a picture behind me. They made over 60 tote bags out of t-shirts for Project Salt so that people can go in and take their stuff. This is an ongoing service project with Project Salt, so if you're like, hey, I can cut, go down there and say, then they'll let you take them home. Take them home, cut them, sell, or not sell them, but tie them, and take them back, and they're happy to have you do it. So if you're looking for something to do and way to give back, that is one. We have small groups, community groups all over the city. We have our fireside chat coming up next week. We have so many things. Women's Bible study is starting. If you're not involved, now is your time to do it. Let's check out morning announcements with Pastor Gilly.
Hi. Good morning, church. My name is Gilly. I'm the youth pastor here at The Place. Get ready for some announcements. First up, I want to let you know that the 25th after 10 a.m. service, we are having a fireside chat. Come learn more about The Place Church. Come learn about the DNA of The Place, what really makes us tick. Come learn how to be deeper and grow roots right here at The Place. We are really excited to be starting a red letter challenge, a new red letter challenge this season. It's going to be awesome. If you were impacted by the red letter challenge last time that we did it, then I would love to sit and chat with you, maybe get a little bit of a recording of just some of your testimony about how it impacted you. We're going to be starting a new red letter challenge, brand new one, later this season, and it's going to be great. We're also going to be doing it with the teens, so we're really excited to take that to the next level at P4T as well. For a little Project Salt news, I want to let everyone know about our Rhinestone Cowboy Gala. We are doing our Wickenburg Annual Gala for Project Salt, and we're going to be doing that at Vulture City. Tickets are $60, but they include a full meal. So $60 each includes a full barbecue meal. There's plenty of seats, plenty of dancing, and a whole lot of fun. So get your tickets. It's going to be happening October 5th. You can see me, or you can go over to Wickenburg Storage and Suites. Tickets are cash or check, please. Lastly, for my friends at P4K, we're going to be having a pirate party. It's going to be happening the last Wednesday of the month, and we're going to be doing something special. The kid that brings the most friends, the most new kids to P4K, is going to be getting their own little treasure chest full of goodies and fun. So you don't want to miss out this. It's going to be a great time. We're thinking about some really fun games, some cool snacks. So it's going to be an awesome time, and I am so excited to be able to dress like a pirate and have some fun. That's all I have for announcements today. I hope you guys have an amazing next week. I hope you have a great rest of your Sunday. I see you next time. I love you. Peace.
Church, we invite you to stand back up as we continue to worship today.
Oh,
This next song is 1,000 hallelujahs, but could you imagine thousands of hallelujahs singing in heaven? I can't wait.
Perhaps creation longs to have the worlds to see. This next song is a song that we learned last week during communion, and I'd like to just enjoy it or invite you to sing along with. Oh, I'm a traveler, far from home. I get lost, but I press on. 'Cause there's a mansion and streets of gold where I belong. Thank you for being our Savior, Lord. We just lift it up to you. We praise you, and we pray that our ears are open, our eyes are open to hear your message today, and we give all glory to you in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You can go ahead and grab a seat. Welcome, everybody. How's 8 a.m. doing today? Yeah, you rowdy bunch of people. I love you. It's great to see you today. You picked a great week to be here. We've been having so much fun recently, really diving into kind of the why, like the why behind the what, right? What, we're here at church, but then the why, like why are we here? What's happening? What's happening in my life? How am I changing? That's what we've been unpacking. But I think it's important in this series too that you learn a little bit about your church and what we do and how we reach out and how we're really serving Jesus, serving our community, but also reaching out even beyond Wickenburg to make an impact. In fact, this church has helped an organization in Flagstaff, Arizona called IBC. Now, that's an acronym for Indian Bible College. And we've been supporting Daniel Esplin and his wife up there for years now. And we invited Daniel to come share a little bit with you, give an update on how everything's going, and just so you guys can meet him and get a chance to chit-chat with him for a minute. Say hi to Daniel as he comes on up. Give me a hug, brother. It's great to have you. There you go.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Man, I love those words. No more pain. Amen.
Amen.
No more sorrow. I don't know about you, but every day I begin to, you know, it's harder to get up every day, you know, a little more aches, a little more pain. And but I'm looking forward to seeing Jesus face to face. Amen. Amen. This is my wife, Corrine, and as Pastor Greg said, we work and serve at the Indian Bible College up in Flagstaff, Arizona. And I'm just going to have my wife introduce herself in a little bit.
Good morning. My name is Corrine Esplin, and I serve at Indian Bible College as the Dean of Women, and I am also one of four vice presidents. But I came to Indian Bible College in 2008 to attend as a student and then joined the staff. First as the registrar, just because the school needed a registrar. But my passion is really comes out of my own story of healing from abuse and trauma. And because of that, what God has brought into my life, the hope and healing that only Jesus can bring, I have a passion to see other Native women living that same hope out in their lives. But we can't do that alone. They say that abuse happens in relationship and healing has to happen in relationship. And IBC's mission statement says Indian Bible College exists to disciple and educate Indigenous Native Christians for lifetimes of biblical ministry and spiritual leadership to their people and the world. And in order to see healthy Native Christians going back to their reservations, it's up to us. Bible College shouldn't just be about the education, because that's not what Jesus was about. Jesus was about transformation. And so the three words that I think really sum up Indian Bible College are biblical, relational, and transformational. So I'm just gonna share three new things that are happening in our lives and at Indian Bible College. And as I just mentioned, the power of healing, one of the tools that we use is mending the soul. Has anybody heard of mending the soul here? Okay, so mending the soul, if you look at it, was really targeted for middle-aged white women, and it's powerful. It's based off of scripture, but a lot of the relevant issues that Native people face, we found were not in mending the soul, so we collaborated with Steve and Celesta Tracy to write and design a new Mending the Soul book called Native Mending the Soul, and it's really for Indigenous people. And the difference in the book is that it focuses a lot on generational trauma from the boarding schools, and there's some other new things that have been that are in the book, and the whole cover, everything is new. So Daniel and I have been part of a team of four people that have been rewriting the materials, and Daniel and I did a lot of the design work on that. The other thing is the Lord has called Daniel and I to a second ministry, but it really ties into Indian Bible College, and that's a ministry to France. It's called Natives to France, and it might sound kind of weird, like, why France? I don't know, but the Lord knows. But the Lord put a burden on my heart for France in 2012, and I spent 4 years praying about it before the Lord answered that prayer and called Daniel and I to go. And so we've been taking trips almost every year, with the exception of COVID and a couple of years after. But we still weren't really sure, okay, God, we're listening to you. We're doing what you've called us to. What do we do now? And immediately the Lord brought IBC's mission statement to mind. And if you caught in there, it says that we're training healthy Native leaders to go back to their reservation and the world. And so IBC was fulfilling the reservation part of it. Our students go to serve at a reservation in the spring semester for a week or more. But we weren't fulfilling the second part of that to the world. And so the Lord called us to start taking students over to France with us. So up to this year was our sixth trip this past summer. We've taken six students over. And so it was really exciting this year because we were able to see the fruit of our trips. One of the students that went with us last year went back this year to serve at a camp in Spain. And believe it or not, it's called Indian Camp, which is really funny. And Daniel and I got to serve there in 2019, and it was the first time we ever stayed in a teepee, and it was in Spain. We've never stayed in one before.
I've never stayed in a teepee ever in my life. We had to go to Spain to stay in a teepee, so.
Yeah, so sorry to break all your stereotypes, but we don't live in teepees. but we stay in one in Spain. And so one of our students went back to serve there this summer, which was really cool. But the two guys that we took with us this year were Navajo, and one of them feels the Lord calling him to go back and serve in either France or Spain. So he's in the process of applying with Greater European Mission to be a missionary over there, which is just so exciting to see God fulfilling that. And then the third thing that is new, I guess, since we've been here last, is I'm working on my master's in counseling. So I need a lot of prayer for that because it's hard work because, you know, we're not very busy. So so we needed something. I needed something else to do. I'm just kidding. But anyways, yeah, just prayer for that. I think just counseling a lot of the girls as the dean of women, I'm dealing with trauma all the time. 99% of our students come in with some form of abuse or trauma. And again, that includes my own story. But I did want to share, if you're curious to know what the reservations are like, I would encourage you to read Isaiah 61. I think that could probably be all of our testimonies because we've all come from whatever those ashes are in our life, addiction, abuse, trauma. I've been there. I understand it. Daniel is actually my second husband. My first husband was an alcoholic, and there was just a lot of unhealthy stuff in both of our lives because neither one of us had ever gone through healing. And so I'm thankful that God has pulled me out of the life that I used to have and called me into this new life to serve him, because once we're saved, God doesn't just want us to stay there. He calls us to serve. And so I encourage you to read Isaiah 61, but it really does talk about the reservations. And I love verse 4. It says, they will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. And I really believe that that's what God has called Daniel and I to do, because the Lord has anointed us to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent us to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners.
Amen. Thank you. Praise God. Thank you, Kareem. Yeah, let's give her a hand. As my wife said, she serves as a dean of women. And she's also a vice president, so I always tell people she's my boss, not only at home, but at work. So, not that she needed a title for that, but. We just want to say thank you so much to the church here for your partnership with us at Indian Bible College, and for, you know, just coming alongside us in that way. As Kareem shared some of the updates, personally, you know, we've been walking through, you know, obviously COVID and some of those things, and to a place now where the school is at a place where I believe Indian Bible College best days are yet to come. And we're praying that God would raise up the next generation of Native leaders. And so we're looking forward to that, and we're just praising God for what he's doing there as well. And one of the things that Kareem shared, you know, she grew up in New York State. She's part of the Seneca tribe. And oftentimes people ask, how did you guys meet? You know, I'm from Arizona. I'm Navajo. I grew up in Arizona. She's Seneca. Like, how did you guys meet? And I always tell people, well, everybody I met on the Navajo Nation, I was related to. So, so I had to marry somebody far, far east. And, but no, we met at the college, and praise God that, you know, God is using us both in ministry, and God is using our stories. God is using not only our strengths, but the areas that we're, you know, we feel like there's some shame there. God is able to take those areas where we feel like maybe like, I don't know if I'm able to share that. Or those areas we think like, God, I don't know, you know, that's kind of a dark area in my life. But praise God that he can take those things and use them for his glory. And one of the verses I want to talk about today is Acts chapter 9. And before I read this, let's just pray. Father God, we thank you so much for your word. Lord, we thank you that, God, you're a God who communicates. You're a God who speaks. Lord, we don't have to wonder what is in your heart. We don't have to wonder what your plans are or what you want for us, God. We can open your word, and God, you speak to us. Thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus. And it is because of him, Lord, we have access to you, the Father. It is because of Jesus, Lord, we have the forgiveness of sins. And Father, just be with us today. Speak to us in Jesus' name. Amen. I mentioned I grew up on the Navajo Nation, a little town called Red Lake, near the Four Corners area. But I grew up there, went to church off and on. I kind of grew up in the traditional ways as well. My grandpa was a medicine man. And so I kind of grew up in and out, you know, knowing both sides of the tracks, I guess if you were to say. And but it wasn't until 2001 when God showed up and God really revealed himself and said, you know what, stop running from me, stop running. And it was in the summer of 2001 when I said, God, I'm done doing things my way. I'm done doing things my way. I'm done. I want to surrender to you. And this passage speaks about a man named Saul as well, who, according to history, a lot of people, you know, they knew Saul. He had the best education. If there was somebody who, you know, could get the best theological training, it was Saul. Saul says, you know, I was the Pharisees of the Pharisees. I was a religious man. If there was somebody, you know, that knew the law, Saul said it was me. If there was somebody who said, you know what, I was the Hebrews of the Hebrews, it was Saul. And in verse 1, it says here in chapter 9 of Acts, meanwhile, Saul was still breathing threats and murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. And he went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. It's interesting, up to this point, Paul, in his heart, in his conscience, he thought he was doing something right. For Saul, he thought he was pleasing God by persecuting God's people. And his mission every day was to wreak havoc into the lives of Christians. And he thought for sure, that he was pleasing God. And I think one of the things that's pretty scary, I guess you could say, is you can be religious, but yet you can be far from God, right? You can be religious. You can do the religious things. You can think that you're pleasing God, but yet your heart can be far from him. And we read here in Acts chapter 9, Saul still breathing murderous threats against God's people. And if he found any belonging to the way, whether men or women, he says, he would take them as prisoners. And for Saul, up to this point, he had been listening to the lies that, you know, what he was doing was pleasing God. He had been listening to the lies, and I truly believe, you know, the enemy's number one goal is to take our eyes off of the Lord. To believe the lies of, you know, just do these things and you'll be okay. And it goes on and says here, and as he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him and he fell to the ground and he heard a voice saying, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Verse 5, who are you, Lord? Saul asked. For the first time in Saul's life, he had heard a voice that was different. For the first time, Saul, he was doing all these religious things, but yet he heard the voice of the Lord. He heard the voice of truth, you see. And I think that's what Jesus is his goal is to try to shake us up, to say, hey, you know what? Don't believe those lies. And for the first time, Saul heard the voice of truth, and his life would never be the same. So what is it that takes a man who is, you know, spiritually dead, a man who is, you know, who has a past, who used to persecute Christians? It's the person of Jesus. Transformation takes place when we encounter the living and breathing God in the person of Jesus. And for Saul, on the road to Damascus, that's what he was doing. And Jesus said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. And now get up and go into the city, and I will tell you what you must do. I love how Jesus, God always has a plan. He always has something for us. He always has a mission for us. It's not just about saving us. It's not just about, you know, showing us who he is. But God always has a mission for us. And as Corrine said in 2012, God put on our hearts, go to France. And Corrine, if she were to tell you the story, long story short, you know, she kept seeing and kind of just, you know, just encountering French things. Like, you know, she would go into the restaurants and there'd be bagels, you know, all on the side. Or no, not bagels, croissants, sorry. Croissant, not bagels. Yeah. And, you know, she would see these French designs and French words and stuff. And she kept saying, I'm, you know, God's speaking to me. And I don't know, all I could think about was French fries, you know, for me. So not really French. But it's crazy that God would send and put that on our hearts, France. And we would ask, why? And when we first went through that door, when we first went to France in 2016, we began to see why God was putting that on our hearts. Because the French people have such a fascination. They have a deep fascination with American Indians. It's crazy. It's weird. It's a little scary. But it's weird. And everywhere we would go, wow, you're American Indian. And they would ask us about these questions and that question. And the conversation would always go to politics and religion. You know, what's happening in America? You know, what do you think of this and that and this and that? And we just like, well, whatever. And then the question of religion, like, you know, they would ask us about spiritual things. They would assume that we would be, you know, into the native religion. But then we would stand there and say, you know what, we are followers of Jesus. But they were confused. They were thinking, how can you be American Indian and how can you follow Jesus? So basically we would share our stories with them. And we would be standing there in France. My wife would be standing in Paris at some of these monuments, sharing the gospel with God, with people who God put in our way. And it's amazing how God here, he says to Saul, get up and go to the city and I will tell you what you must do. God always has a mission for us. I'm going to fast forward a little bit. You guys all know the story. Saul went blind for a while, and he, you know, he was unable to see. He went into the city of Damascus, and God calls this guy Ananias. And Ananias, God tells Ananias, go to the street, call straight. And when you go to this place, go into the house and you'll see a man named Saul of Tarsus. And Ananias is like, wait, God, hold on, God. It's interesting, before that, Ananias is like, Lord, here I am. But yet now he's kind of questioning God. He's like, God, you know about this man, right? You know about this guy, Saul. He's a murderer. He's a persecutor. And you want me to go to him? And Ananias is like, wait. But God says, yeah, go, and you'll meet a guy named Saul. But I love this, how God refers to Saul. In verse 15, he says, but the Lord said to Ananias, he says, go. This man, he's talking about Saul, is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles, to the kings and to the people of Israel. And I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Lord, I love how God describes Saul. He says, Saul is my chosen instrument. Saul is my chosen instrument. You know, I grew up in a little town called Red Lake on the Navajo Nation. I was ashamed of where I came from. I was ashamed of kids who would ask me, hey, is your mom or dad coming to school to visit, or like during parent-teacher conference? My dad left when I was 8 years old. I was ashamed because my dad was an alcoholic. And I would ask God, why did you make me this color? God, why am I from the Navajo Nation? And I would ask God these questions. But I love the fact that God refers to Saul. He says, he is my chosen instrument. You see what an instrument is? An instrument, its purpose is to make music, right? An instrument has value and worth. Why? Because of what it was designed for. And oftentimes I would be kind of an instrument. I would be like a guitar and say, you know what? I don't like that I have 6 strings. God, why did you make me this way? Why can't you make me with 2 strings? And God was saying to me, you know what? I designed you for 6 strings. I designed you to make music. And point number one is, God don't make mistakes. God don't make mistakes. And I love how he refers to Saul. He tells Ananias, I didn't make a mistake with Saul too. He is my chosen instrument. And he says, to take my name to the Gentiles, to the kings of the world, he says. And I love the fact of how God refers to us as an instrument. An instrument, we have a guitar, bass, we have a keyboard, we have drums, various instruments can make various music. And sometimes we ask God, Lord, why did this happen? Why did this? Why did that? And I think the question should be, Lord, how do you want me to make music for you? How do you want me to reach the people in my family, in my backyard? How do you want me to make music for you, Lord? Because for Saul, he says here, he's my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles, to the kings, and to the people of Israel, he says. That was Saul's purpose. You see, an instrument wasn't designed to hang on the wall. It wasn't designed to sit and collect dust. It was designed to play, to strum, to make music. And when I began to realize it, when we began to go to France, we began to share our stories, it was amazing to see, like, God taking this young little boy from the Navajo reservation and using him in a country where there's less than 1% of Christians, in a country that doesn't believe in God, in a country that believes that God is for the people centuries ago. But to be able to make music for God in France, and to come home and say, and to encourage other young Native men to say, you are a chosen instrument. And my challenge to you guys today, how can you make music for God today? Maybe it's coming up and speaking it and sharing your story. Maybe it's just listening to somebody who is hurting. Just being, a place where somebody can share their hurts, share their needs. Maybe it is sharing those areas in your life of saying, you know what, this is how God healed me. This is how God showed up. And it's a marvelous thing to hear God's people make music for him. Is it going to be easy? No. Look at verse 16. God says, I will show Saul, I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake. There's going to be times when it's going to be difficult. There's going to be times when we're going to say, you know what, Lord, I don't know if I can do this anymore. Lord, I don't know if I can walk through this. Lord, there's nobody else in my family. Lord, there's nobody else that's coming along. Be God's instrument. Make music for the Lord by sharing your story, sharing the praises of what God has done in your life. Make music for him. And that's what as my wife and I just shared earlier, we want to thank you. We want to thank you for the partnership to be able to come together. Even though you guys are down here, we feel the prayers. We feel the encouragement. And we just want to thank you guys for that as well. Let us pray. Father God, thank you, Lord, that our past, our failures, our sin, our disobedience, Lord, is not too much for you. Lord, our sin is not great. Your mercy is more. Lord, your son Jesus is what gives us hope. Father, Lord, if we're an instrument sitting on the wall collecting dust, Lord, may we shake off those cobwebs and begin to make music for you, Lord. Whether it be sharing our story or just, Lord, memorizing scripture or telling people about you, inviting in the church, whatever it may be, God. Father, I pray those who don't know you today, Lord, that they would find that they would be reminded, Lord, that Jesus died for their sins. Lord, that he has given us everlasting life. Father, we thank you for your love and mercy. We thank you, Lord, it is your kindness that leads us to repentance. Father, we just thank you and praise you for all that you've done and all that you will do. In Jesus' mighty, matchless name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Will you guys give it up for Daniel and his wife?
Great job, bro. Great job.
It's so exciting to hear what God is doing just up the mountain. It's really not that far, but he's working. And even over the pond, we hear, you know, through the Esplins and how God is using them. In just a minute, we're going to have the opportunity to give here as the church. And as I was thinking this week, I came across this verse. You got a verse for me back there, Gilly? Alrighty then. All right, so, when we look at giving today, I just want to say God loves a cheerful giver. Amen? Amen. That's an important thing. Let's pray. Father God, I want to thank you so much for the incredible blessing of being here today. I thank you, Father, for the offering that we're about to take. I pray that it's used for your glory on this earth. I pray that it blesses many, Father. Thank you, Lord, for today. Bless the Esplins. Use them in a mighty, mighty way on this earth. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen. As our front line team comes forward, would you please join us in the chorus of Face to Face? Please sing along with.
When we all see Jesus, when we all see Jesus, no more sickness, no more madness, no more. Jesus, face to face.
Let's do that one more time. Three.
When we all see Jesus, when we all see Jesus, no more sickness, no more madness, no more pain.
My name is Lisa. Will you help me in saying our closing prayer? God, help me live for you every day this week. Where there is darkness, help me shine. Where there is need, help me serve. Where there is pride, humble me. But every day, in every way, I choose to follow you. And we are making a difference on this earth. God bless you. Have a great week.